Well, hello and welcome to this week's edition of our Wednesday Bible study. We have been working our way through church history. We began very early on in the days of Pentecost, and now we've made our way through the summer on Wednesdays up until the point where we talk about the Associate Presbyterians in Scotland. Our own denomination's history is we are Associate Reformed Presbyterians. 2 weeks ago, we talked about what it means to be Presbyterian in the context of the Scottish Reformation. Last week, we talked about the idea of what it means to be Reformed Presbyterian with reference to the Covenanters and the Covenanting Movement. And then today, we're going to talk about the Associates, the Associate Presbyterians, and what that means for us to be Associate Presbyterians, or as they were known in Scottish church history, as Seceders. They seceded in 1733 from the Church of Scotland. There were 5 to 6 ministers who met at a place called Gerney Bridge. Once they met there, they formed their own presbytery, and within 10 years, there were some 25 ministers, and there were 40-some churches and 3 presbyteries, and God began to work. It wasn't until the 2 groups, Reformed Presbyterians and Associate Presbyterians, came to America before they joined in 1782, which was the beginning stages of what we know as the Associate Reformed Presbyterian Church. Primarily, we're going to start our time today in the years between 1690 and 1707 in the land of Scotland. The time between the Revolution settlement in 1690 and the union of the Scottish and English parliaments in 1707. Those two dates kind of form the beginning and the end of a tumultuous period in the life of Scotland that shaped not only the people but also the church, as is typically the case. But before we do any of that, let's pause for prayer and to read a word from God's scripture. So we're going to read from James chapter 2, verses 1 through 7 today, and then I'll have a prayer for us. This is what James says with reference to the sin of partiality. My brothers, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing comes in also, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, you sit here in a good place, while you were to say to the poor man, you stay over there, or sit down at my feet, have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you were called? Now I'm going to continue on just because I feel like I need to right now. Verse 8, if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scriptures, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. And if you do not commit adultery but do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Pray with me, please. Our Father and our God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity we have to come through this virtual communication. We thank you for our rich heritage. And we pray, Lord, as we turn our attention to the Associate Presbyterians, and the Erskine brothers, and Thomas Boston, and others. Lord, we pray that you will speak to our hearts, encourage us, strengthen us, inform us, convict us, challenge us, prepare us as we build upon their legacy, and warn us, Lord, because they weren't perfect. They were humans just like the rest of us. And they did things that worked well, and they did things that didn't work well. They had joy-filled spirits and really passionate, pure spirits, but at the same time, they had some cantankerous tendencies and maybe even some desire to be schismatic. And so, Lord, we just pray that you'll help us as we work through this, give us the proper perspective, but also the better understanding of who we are and how we build upon the legacy we have inherited as Associate Reformed Presbyterians. For it's in Christ we pray. Amen. Now, before we read the scriptures, I told you we were going to spend our time talking about a time period at the beginning of our lesson today between 1609 and 1707. 1690, excuse me, and 1707. The time between the Revolution settlement that came after the killing times when the Covenanters were killed after they had armed revolt against the government, and then a the union of the Scottish and English parliaments in 1707. There are a variety of things that happened that really affected the life of the Scottish church and the lives of the Scots and the lives of the church members. There was the challenge of the reigns of Charles II and James III. Those two men had brought many challenges to the church. We know that Charles II was the one who refused to sign the National Covenant through whom the Killing Times, or under whose leadership the Killing Times took place. The Age of Reason that we currently are coming to the conclusion of right now in our society had just dawned in Europe. And so the skepticism of the Age of Reasoning was really starting to shape the society in which these people lived. Scots were very poor during this time. It was an incredibly impoverished nation. In the 17th century, Scottish people were incredibly impoverished. So there was a poverty there in Scotland. There was also an ongoing economic conflict with England. England's always been the big brother, and the big brother has always had more money, always held it over the little brother. And so with reference to that union, England and Scotland had this economic conflict going. Then in 1707, there was this union of the two. The crown had already been unified under James in 1607, I believe we said last week, and so, or 1603. The crown was unified under James in 1603, but the parliaments remained separate until 1707. There was also a great fear in Scotland that the French would take over Britain, and there was a lot of interaction between the French and the kings of England that had a lot to do with their histories and their backgrounds and their histories as royal families were interwoven. And there was a concern that when the French took over Britain, that they would impose Roman Catholicism on the land. And so that was a big concern as well. And then there was an emergence of a spirit of toleration, of religious toleration, something that had not been the case up until this point. And so all of these different factors were working together to shape the climate in which the Scottish church lived, and in which these, what we call seceders, who became the Associate Presbyterians, began their ministry, came of age in their ministry, and served within the context of the church. And so all these factors are playing together to impact the way in which these folks thought and believed. But there are three main issues that kind of come out of these factors, three main issues that arise that require, that force the covenant, force the Associate Presbyterians to secede. And it's important to note that they called themselves seceders. They didn't call themselves schismatics. They didn't call themselves sectarian. They didn't call themselves divisive. They wanted to secede from the Church of Scotland because they had some specific issues. It wasn't they wanted a complete split, but they wanted to address some particular issues, and so they wanted to secede in a peaceful way from the Church of Scotland. Of course, that rarely ever works. We know that from our own history here in the United States. That rarely ever works that way because inevitably the group from which a certain people secede, that group considers those seceders not as seceders or peaceful people. They consider them as combatant, and they consider them as those who are going against the establishment. And so this group of seceders pulled away, and they did in 1733 officially at Gairney Bridge. But there are three main things that really come to the foreground as they're working through the process, really of about 20 years of trying to determine whether or not they're going to secede. The first has to do with their discontentment with the Revolution settlement. In 1690, the General Assembly of the Church and of Scotland itself passed a resolution, a settlement, where there was a desire in the established church to bring back into the fold of what was known as the Scottish Kirk, Covenanters as well as Episcopalians. And when they passed this resolution settlement, they went back to a period of time in 1500s, in 1592, and adopted an act of Parliament in 1592 that said Presbyterianism is the established government of Scotland and of Scotland's churches. But as they went back, the seceders had problems because from 1690 it ignored some of the gains that the church had made in the covenanting period. Covenanting with the church, making sure that the church of England and the king could not impose bishops on them. They made some great strides in some assemblies that met during during the covenantal period. We talked about this last week. But going back 100 years and really adopting a position that was held 100 years ago was troublesome to the seceders, and here's why. If that position we held 100 years ago with reference to the government of the church, the authority of God's word, the purity of worship, if that resolution was so strong, then King Charles would have never been able to impose the papacy or impose, excuse me, bishops or prelacy on us, which means a church ruled by bishops, an episcopal style of leadership. If it was so strong, they would have never been able to force the prayer book on us. If it was so strong, they would have never been able to give us canons that we had to follow in the church. And so their idea was, why don't we go back to something that has already been broken and it wasn't strong enough to protect us? Why would we go back to it? If it happened before, it can happen again. And that makes sense when you think about it. The other issue, though, is that they believe that the covenant gave them standing to do some things that are very important. And they believe that as a church is responsible to God, that the church of Jesus Christ had the responsibility to make strong recommendations to the king and the parliament about evils in the modern world or in the land, and so severe evils. And so they thought the church should be able to speak into the government of the land and say these are evils that need to be addressed through legislation. And they believed that a covenant with the king enabled them to do that. And so they didn't want to give up the gains that the church had made in this covenanting period. But when the church says we'll go back and adopt something in 1592, basically they're setting aside those gains that they got during the covenanting period. And so there was a discontent with that revolution settlement. It was the idea that we wanted to maintain purity at all cost. Keep peace, and the General Assembly wanted to keep peace in the church. They wanted to keep the voice of dissent relatively low. They wanted to avoid the government thinking, again, that there were a renewal of the covenanting ideas that led to the covenanting rebellion. But the seceders had a philosophy that said, we need to strive for purity. If we've made it this far, we need to strive for purity in doctrine. We need to strive for purity in worship. We need to strive for purity in church government. And we just do it at all costs, even if that includes schism. We're only going to stop short of rebellion, of armed rebellion against the king. And the established church of Scotland says, wait a minute, we've got a different philosophy. We want to strive to keep peace and stability of the church. We're going to avoid schism, avoid separation, avoid split at all costs and open contention. And we're going to wait for a moment to adopt more profitable and more secure legislation. In other words, it was the idea of saying, let's keep the peace and let's keep the government from thinking that we're going to rebel again. Now, we can look at those two positions, and on one hand, some of us would say, man, I'm all for the seceders. I believe, let's go, right? There's a kind of a discontented spirit when it comes to that. I don't want to be a part of the establishment. I want to make change. We're seeing that play out in our own politics right now. But then there's that other side of the establishment that says, let's keep peace. Let's strive to keep peace, and let's look for the most appropriate time to make changes, right? So let's look for an appropriate and profitable time to make changes, but let's not rock the boat too much right now. The General Assembly, position of not rocking the boat too much. They wanted to bring in covenanters. They wanted to bring in Episcopals. They wanted to grow the church, strengthen the church, and bring it back together in unity and work with the crown to develop steps to move forward as they came out of the revolution time during the covenanting period. The seceders said, no, we need to keep going. We finally got purity. We need to keep striving for it, regardless of the cost. So that's the first thing. Second thing is seceders were discontented with the assembly's attitude towards supposed heretics. So there was a trial in the Church of Scotland that made its way to the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. It had to do with someone preaching what we know as Arminian doctrines, which basically means that the idea that God is not sovereign in salvation. And so the assembly said, you're in error, but they allowed the minister, to hold to those positions, just not able to teach those positions to the congregation. And the seceder said, you need to discipline him. You need to excommunicate him. We can't just allow him to hold that position. We've got to excommunicate him. And so they were unhappy and discontented with the assemblies dealing with alleged heretics or supposed heretics in its midst. Again, they were striving for purity at all cost. Right? People who strive for purity at all cost are people who want to make pure and say, you know what, the most important thing is purity of the church. And it may make us cause us to break fellowship. It may cause us to break peace at times. It may cause us to ruffle feathers. But the reality of it is it's more important to pursue purity than it is to pursue anything else. And so they were discontented. Now, again, this is probably something that we look at, many of us in the modern world, and say, what is wrong with these people? They're cantankerous and they're ornery. They need to work with peace, and they need to work to strive to make things right and work at the proper time and try to help each other along. And so our modern sensibilities are offended, perhaps, when we hear about stories of the past. But that doesn't necessarily mean there's a problem with those in the past. It could very well mean that it's a problem with us, that we take discipline too lightly. And we're too quick to compromise, and we're too quick to smooth things over because we don't want to ruffle feathers, or we don't want to put people out, or we don't want to challenge people, we don't want to do the hard things. I'm not arguing one way or the other. I just think that there's a point in which when we look at these things, we have to look at them as the context, but also look at them not only with eyes that look back in faith to the Lord, but also look back at these men and say, you know what, they were faithful to the Lord, and we respect them. And eyes that look back and criticize them, perhaps, for being too harsh in different things, we need to also be looking at our own selves and criticizing our own selves by the virtue of the truth. And so they were discontented with the assembly's attitude towards supposed heretics. And thirdly, they were discontented with the assembly's attitude toward evangelical doctrine. So again, these men left the Church of Scotland, formed their own presbytery in 1733. Building up to that, there were two doctrinal controversies, and doctrine means theology, theological controversies that really shaped and affected the Church of Scotland. The first has to do with Auctoritative Creed. And the creed states this: it was a presbytery that held to a creed. And the creed, in addition to the Westminster Standards, the creed says this: it is not sound and orthodox doctrine to teach that we must forsake sin in order to our coming to Christ and in stating us in covenant with God. What does that mean? Well, there was a teaching of the day that had to do with, it was a legalistic teaching that said you had to repent of your sins before you could trust Jesus. So it made repentance a work of faith, a work of salvation prior to the expression of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, all of us believe that faith and repentance are essential to conversion. You trust Christ and repent of your sins. That means you've converted to Christianity. But to say you have to repent before you can trust Christ is to take away the free grace of God. And so this presbytery was fighting against a doctrine that was being taught in the Church of Scotland at that time. And they held to this creed. And it all goes back to this idea that there was at one time a young man who was approved for the ministry, but he didn't give a satisfactory answer to this creed and to the positions of this creed, which were ancillary to his ordination questions. So in other words, when I was licensed as a minister, I have certain questions set up by the denomination, the formal government of the Associate Reformed Presbyterian Church. And I have to give affirmation to those questions. And this young man gave affirmations to the questions that the Church of Scotland had put forward. But when it came to this question of the creed, he didn't give an adequate answer with reference to the position of the presbytery, with reference to this particular issue of, is repentance necessary prior to coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior? So the presbytery said, all right, you've been approved for licensure, but we're not going to give you the license, which means you can't practice your ministry in Scotland without that license. Well, he appeals naturally to the Synod, which then appeals to the General Assembly, which says basically they can't do that. Well, the General Assembly comes down harsh on the presbytery, not with reference to the presbytery's position, but comes down harsh on the presbytery for how the presbytery added to the documents and requirements of the formal government of the Church of Scotland at that time. The seceders grabbed a hold of this idea later on, and it's not because they had issues with how this young man was treated. It's not because they had issues with reference to the presbytery itself. Not because they had issues with reference to the denomination and the presbytery. They grabbed a hold of this because they thought this was a fundamental issue that needed to be addressed in the Church of Scotland. Can the gospel of Jesus Christ be offered to everyone? And are certain acts of faith required prior to trusting in Jesus? And of course, the answer to both those questions is yes and no, right? Yes, the gospel should be offered to everyone. It is a general call. Everyone who hears the truth of the gospel should hear the good news of Jesus and be called to repent and turn and follow him. And no, repentance is not necessary before you come to fight Christ. In fact, we would argue as good Calvinists that repentance is only possible after you've come to Christ, after you've been remade and regenerated by the grace and mercy of God through the work of the Holy Spirit. Which leads to the second issue. The second issue was what was called the Marrow Controversy. There's a little book that was published in 1646 by a guy named Edward Fisher. It's right here. I have it right here, but it's called The Marrow of Modern Divinity. The Marrow of Modern Divinity was a book that was printed. It was a devotional book, and it was found by Thomas Boston. And Thomas Boston was one of the seceders, and he began to read it and began to recommend it to others to be read. Now, this is different than what you would consider a devotional book. We use things like, you know, My Utmost for His Highest, or we use maybe even some of the things that we give out, Daily Bread, Upper Room, etc., that is a passage of Scripture and then an explanation. Maybe some of us use things from Charles Spurgeon or whatnot. This was a different time. This was a 17th century devotional book. Marrow of Modern Divinity was written by Edward Fisher, and it's written in a style that's very fascinating, but it's a conversation between four men. The first is a man named Evangelist. He is a minister of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The second is Nomista. He is a legalist. The third is Antinomista. He is what's called an antinomian, or somebody who's against the law, anti the law of God. And the last is Neophytus, who was a young Christian. And these guys, the legalist and the antinomian, bring their concerns and their argument to the Christian minister. The young Christian is trying to learn what it is to be truly a follower of Christ. And the Christian minister and the evangelical minister, through the process, is correcting both the sin of and the issue of legalism, the error of legalism, and the error of antinomianism, and trying to disciple the young man in ministry, to a young man as he grows in the faith. It's a fascinating concept. Well, a number of men read these books. They became known as the Marrow Men, and they had an issue with the General Assembly. And they believed that the General Assembly had closed the door to people coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, had ceased its evangelistic activities and outreach, and become legalistic in its understanding of Christian doctrine. They argued, the General Assembly believed that, the Marrow Men believed, that you didn't have to repent, you could trust Christ, then repentance followed. And the General Assembly argued that it was necessary to follow the law when a man and woman came to Christ. It was absolutely necessary. And so this debate raged, and it continued on. In 1720, it made its way to the floor. Ebenezer Erskine, Ralph Erskine, Thomas Hogg, and Thomas Boston spoke on behalf of the Marrow Men. They were censured. 1721, 1722, they continued to have this debate. And they were starting this process of seceding away even then, because they had this tremendous disagreement theologically with the General Assembly. But the key factor that forced the secession movement was in 1726 over an issue of patronage. Now, patronage was this practice in the Church of Scotland that was prescribed throughout all of Britain, but certainly in the Church of Scotland and in England. Patronage was a practice where the hereditary landowner, or the landed gentry of the land, of the parish, or the parish council that had been appointed by the king, had the right to call or present the pastor. They had a supposed authority to call / present the pastor. Ultimately, the presbytery had the responsibility to give its approval on whether or not this man would fit in this parish, and they would approve it. But to present the name to the presbytery was the responsibility of the landed gentry and or the town council, as appointed by Westminster, as appointed by the king. So in 1726, Kinross congregation south of Perth wanted to call Ebenezer Erskine to be their minister. The patron of the parish, the landed gentry, did not want that to be the case, perhaps because he knew that Erskine was tied into the Merryman controversy. Perhaps he knew that Erskine was adamantly opposed to patronage as a whole. So he presented someone different than the man the congregation wanted. He presented a licentiate, a probationary minister, and brought him before the presbytery. The congregation refused that young man as their minister, and the presbytery refused to ordain that young man as the minister of that church. This debate, this situation goes on 6 years. Finally, in 1732, a commission of the presbytery ordains this young man and calls him and installs him as the pastor of Kinross, the Kirk session there, and the congregation itself bars the door and won't let him in. 1732, Ebenezer Erskine happens to have already taken his call in Stirling, and he happens to be the moderator of the synod of that year. And he preaches a sermon against patronage as he finishes up. Obviously, he is very much affected personally by this issue. But his argument was that of James's, which I read when we got started. To let the landed gentry or the town council or even the landowners in the congregation make the decision for the entire congregation was to sow partiality to those who had means over those who don't have means. Erskine believed wholeheartedly, and the majority of Christians in the area believed wholeheartedly, that the whole congregation, men and women, had the right and responsibility to call their pastor. No one had the right and responsibility to impose a pastor upon them. They had the right and the responsibility to call their pastor. And you would agree. Absolutely, you would agree. The rich people don't get to call the pastor for the poor people. The landed gentry who's inherited a bunch of land doesn't get to call the pastor for everybody else. And he fought adamantly against this, as did other men who also happened to be aligned with him on the Merrow controversy. 1732 is a benchmark moment. It comes after 1731, naturally, but it comes after 1731 when the church had tried to put together a compromise between those who wanted patronage and those who didn't. And those who refused patronage fought against the compromise as heartedly as they fought against patronage itself. And so, in 1733... Ebenezer Erskine, his brother Ralph, Alexander Moncrief, William Wilson, James Fisher, and Thomas Mayer left to form the Associate Presbytery. They seceded from the Church of Scotland to form the Associate Presbytery at Gairney Bridge. They just formed their own presbytery. And they wanted to do this because they wanted authority to preach the gospel. They believed in Presbyterian form of government. They brought with them their congregations. They wanted authority to preach the gospel, to administer the sacraments. They wanted to have authority to speak into issues in the land that they needed as an established church, as an institution. They also wanted to maintain a relationship with the Church of Scotland. They didn't want to just walk away. You see, in our modern world, we just think, man, I'm just going to walk away, I'm done, right? We get mad at a church, we just walk away. Go somewhere else, or we just break fellowship and we're done. We got some kind of issue come up, we break fellowship. They didn't want to break fellowship with the Church of Scotland. They wanted to maintain a fellowship. That's why they thought of themselves as seceders, not as schismatics or sectarian. And of course, the Church of Scotland said, you've got to be kidding me. By 1744, the Associate Presbytery had grown into a denomination with three presbyteries, 25 ministers, and 41 congregations. It had 16 vacant congregations. The congregations came out and went with them. And you can understand why. There's an appeal. Appeal to the gospel. Appeal to the free offer of the gospel. Appeal to equality within the context of who has the responsibility and right to vote to call the minister. When I took this call to this church, I was handed a call at my installation service by the clerk of presbytery or the moderator of presbytery. That call stated the terms of the call, basically what the salary was going to be and how the church had promised to take care of me and my family. On the back of that call was a list of signatures, and we still do this today. When a congregation votes to call a minister, the congregation signs a document and pledges their fidelity to that minister and says, we vote and vow to take care of you upon these conditions. That's a wonderful blessing. Everybody, I can go back and look at it. I can see older members. I can see younger members. I can see members with means and members without means. I can look and see everybody who's placed their name on that. It is a wonderful encouragement. And that's what Erskine said should happen. People flocked. Not larger than the Church of Scotland ever, but people flocked. Now, here's the deal. I want to say as we wrap this up, as we're coming to a conclusion, I think there are several different things that we can take from this. Some of them are very positive, and one of them is not. One of them is that there's a positive is there's an insistence upon grace, the grace of God. We see that the Marrow men and the Erskines and those who formed the Associate Presbytery insisting on the grace of God. We've got to trust in Christ, but we give the grace of God the efficacy to call whom He wishes, and we give God the efficacy to accomplish His work of salvation. It is through His grace, not through anything we do, but solely through the grace of God. Tremendous important. Second is this idea of the free offer of the gospel, that we go out and call other people to trust in Jesus. Hey, God loves you. He wants you to live in a relationship with Him. Come and follow Him. Jesus doesn't withhold the call. You see Him walking through the streets. He calls sick and invalid, impoverished, as well as rich and wealthy, and even scoundrels like Levi, Pharisees and Sadducees, come and follow Me. And so we call people to follow Jesus. It's up to them to respond to that call, the grace of God in their lives. We also note that the right of the congregation to call its own pastor. An equality of membership. There's no partiality in the Church of Jesus Christ. Foot of the cross, foot of the ground, the ground at the foot of the cross is equal. But there's in level. There is no partiality. Rich and poor alike, landowners and non-landowners, men and women. There's neither slave nor free, nor Jew nor Greek, nor man nor woman. In the eyes of God, we have the right to stand before the presence of God. Doesn't mean those distinctions go away. But what it means is that they do not come into play when it comes to our relationship with God and our standing in the church. And so everyone has a vote. Everyone has a role in calling a pastor, and everyone has a responsibility and a privilege of being a part of that. If it weren't for the Erskines, we wouldn't be there. If it weren't for the seceders, we wouldn't be there. The Church of Scotland, ultimately, within a number of maybe 10 years or so, gets rid of the whole idea of patronage and reforms. And it's, I believe, due to the fact that these men pushed it. They had to secede, and then they refused to come back, but they had to secede in order to push it. But there's also a warning here against sectarianism, because these men could have returned, but they refused to return to the Church of Scotland. The Church of Scotland made many overtures to them to return. They refused to return because they never thought it was pure enough. They never thought it was reformed enough. And that we can always find ourselves in a situation like that. We want to stand for something strong. We want to seek purity, but we don't want to be sectarian and schismatic. I fear that sometimes we can be that way, and I fear sometimes we see that even in our own denomination in the modern world, that this is one of those, you know, we have this great legacy of the associates that all about the free offer of the gospel and the equality of men, women, and children to call their own pastor, the idea of the insistence upon God's grace. But we also can be cantankerous, ornery, and secessionist. And secessionist. And so I think that there's I think we need to learn from this. I think we could very much learn from the tendency to be a little ornery, cantankerous. Perhaps we need to reevaluate that there's always that danger there. When you stand for something so strongly, it can be a danger when you allow it to dominate who you are. So we look back, I said earlier, we look back, we have to look back with eyes of respect and love and adoration. We look back with an understanding. We look back through lenses that have been shaped by the world in which we live, and we look back and we evaluate where they are and the struggles they have, because no one lives in a vacuum. But I think we also have to look at ourselves and say, all right, are we being faithful to the calling and seeking the peace and purity and prosperity of the church. I don't know, but I think we need to evaluate that. I really do. I don't know what the answer is right now. But I toss that out there for us to consider. Evaluate the past. Appreciate, be thankful for. I love the Erskines. I love Thomas Boston. I love Moncrief. I love Wilson. I love those guys. And I'm thankful for James Fisher and Thomas Mayer. And I'm thankful for Gurney Bridge. And I'm thankful those forefathers kept the faith and pressed on. And in 1782, joined with the Reformed Presbyterians in Philadelphia. But I also realize that they're like me. And I don't have it all together, and I'm not perfect, nor are you. And so I don't want to fall into the temptation of hero worshiping. And I want to learn, and I want to evaluate, and I want to learn how to follow Jesus more fully, because I think ultimately that was their desire. And I think that is all of our desires, and that's the goal for all of our lives. How do we glorify God and enjoy Him forever? I'm starting to ramble, so I'll stop. But thank you guys so much for joining us. Next week, we'll talk about the union of the two and get up to the modern era as we work our way through and hopefully finish this Bible study next week as we get ready to meet back together on August 24th in person. You guys take care. God bless you. I'll see you next time.